And share screen. We want to welcome everybody to our class tonight, class number 3 on the Holy Spirit. Tonight's session is on the ministry of the Holy Spirit in the life of Christ. And so that's what we're going to talk about tonight. You know, we can think of great partners in human relationships, how a husband needs a wife, a mother and a father work together in raising kids. Disciples were sent 2 by 2 to evangelize in Matthew 10. The Bible talks about partnering in a plurality of elders to lead the church. Paul and Barnabas were a team. The Avengers, or Batman and Robin, depending of your Marvel or DC, shows the value of partnerships. And tonight we're going to talk about the partnership of the Lord Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. And you might wonder, why is it that they need to be partners? Because they're God and Jesus can do everything in his own power. The Holy Spirit can do everything in his own power. And so why are they partnering up? And so tonight, I hope it'll be an interesting lesson for us tonight as we deepen our appreciation for the triune God. When I mean triune God, I mean God is one God, one in essence, but he's three persons, and how the Trinity works together. Grant Cole mentioned so very often these days, the Spirit is subordinated to Jesus in our thinking. But pre-Pentecost, the incarnate Son is very much under the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. And so, you know, a lot of times the Holy Spirit doesn't get his due. You know, we think after the book of Acts, you know, now the Holy Spirit's working the church. That's when the Holy Spirit became alive. No, he was very active in the Old Testament. He was involved in creation. Even before creation, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit had the perfect fellowship and eternal knowledge of each other. And then creation in the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit was very active and coming upon individuals for a specific task, for a specific time, for a specific purpose. He was he gifted artisans. He gave the word of God to prophets. And so he was very much active in the Old Testament. He's very much active in, you know, in our lives today in New Testament times. But we don't really know a whole lot, or the church hasn't really paid attention to the scriptures of the Holy Spirit in the life of Christ. You know, we normally think Jesus did all those miracles because he's God and he could do them. What we need to notice is that many of those miracles, there's some he did on his own because he's fully capable of doing it. But most of what he did was empowered by the Holy Spirit. Now, why is that? And that's what we're going to uncover in our study today. Let's start at the beginning, the beginning of the life of Christ, where the Holy Spirit is the creative agent in Christ's virgin birth. We know that the angel answered and said to her, that's to Mary, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the highest will overshadow you. Therefore, also, the Holy One is to be born, will be called the Son of God. So here, when Mary is asking for an explanation, how she as a virgin is going to get pregnant and to bear the Son of God, the angel says it's the Holy Spirit who will be the one who gives this conception in her. He implants what would be the embryo of the Lord Jesus miraculously in Mary. Sinclair Ferguson worded it this way. Thus, the inaugurator of the new humanity. The second man is brought into the world by the Spirit's agency. His virgin conception is therefore essential to our salvation and was fittingly brought to pass by the Spirit, who is the executive of that salvation. And so here we get this sense that that this was the divine act by the Holy Spirit. I love what Cole said in his description. The conception of the Messiah is Spirit crafted with possible echoes of the primordial creation narrative. So he's saying it kind of gives this idea out of nothing. God created the universe out of, you know, he didn't need Mary's egg. He didn't need Joseph's sperm. He was able to create the flesh to which Jesus would be conceived. And so that's what he talks about and linking it to this. It's an image of the primordial creation and probably one of the glory that descended on the tabernacle, right? And so how the glory came on that visible presence of access to God in the tabernacle, in the same way the glory of Christ came in human flesh. So, you know, so it's interesting because we talk about the virgin birth. The birth was as ordinary as any other birth, except for the person who was born. So it's not that a virgin birth is the miracle. And, you know, because virgins have given birth, you know, through in vitro fertilization today in modern technology. What's amazing is the virgin conception that the humanity of Jesus was placed in Mary by virgin birth. So here we get the effect of the potency of the virgin birth. You know, then Joseph was pretty upset, and he had to have the explanation from the angel. You know, her betrothed husband, whom they have not, has not consummated the marriage yet. And so the angel appears, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take you Mary, your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. So we have, again, this confirmation. He told Mary and he told Joseph, it's the Holy Spirit who is the agent of this conception. It's a fulfillment of the prophecy in Isaiah 7:14 that God would bear the Messiah through a virgin. And later on in Matthew, verses 24 to 25, it also confirms that Joseph and Mary had not consummated their marriage yet. So this is something that we give to the Holy Spirit. Now, how exactly did that work? It will be a tremendous miracle that we would not be able to replicate or explain. But it does involve the issue of what we call the union of the divine nature. Hypostasis is just a fancy word. If you remember, we talked about the hypostatic union in our Christology class. It's just a fancy way to say the union of the divine nature and the human nature. All right. So here in the virgin birth, you know, as cool as in vitro fertilization could be and other miraculous things, even if they were to create a human life, how do you link the divine nature to the human nature, right? I mean, that's a stupendous miracle that is way beyond any human capability. That is a work of the Holy Spirit. We don't know how it was done, but it was done. And the Holy Spirit knew how to do that. Also, the process of the virgin birth was an issue to the sinlessness of Christ. You know, not that Christ could become sinful, but Robert Gromacki pointed out, from the production of the egg out of Mary's ovary to the actual birth, if there was a production of the egg, you know, we don't really know, But the fetal state in Mary's womb was entirely under the controlling, sanctifying ministry of the Holy Spirit. All right, so the Holy Spirit is the one who is just protecting her. And there, it didn't come from a man to whom a sinful nature would be passed on, right? And you know, or even if it came from Eve, you know, there was no sinful nature that was passed on. And so the virgin birth was a way of ensuring that the sinful nature would not be passed on to the human Christ. So again, it's a miracle of the Holy Spirit, and it's the very fact that that the divine and the human were put together, and to the very fact that Christ is sinless is the result of this miracle of the virgin birth. All right, now we need to be careful a little bit to think, you know, was this the only option? Could God have produced a sinless Savior in another way? You know, in God's great wisdom, he could have, right? Is the virgin birth the only way that it could have been done? No, but because it was done this way, it united the two natures, and it guarded from the sinlessness of Christ, right? Not that Christ could ever have sinned, but you know, it didn't involve the process by which we became sinners. Also, during the virgin birth, so not only did the Holy Spirit instruct Joseph and Mary the process, not only did he perform the procedure of conception in the womb of Mary, but also he was involved in rejoicing in the virgin birth. When Elizabeth heard the greeting, the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with who? The Holy Spirit. And she exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you, Mary. Blessed are you among women. Out of all the women, Mary, you're so blessed. Blessed is the fruit of your womb, who is Jesus." So what inspired Elizabeth to do this? You know, how did Elizabeth know who was in the womb of her cousin Mary, her younger cousin Mary? You know, it was the Holy Spirit that filled Mary to do that. We also see, I don't have it here, but we also see her husband, Zechariah, in Luke 1:67. Her husband, Zechariah, also was filled with the Holy Spirit. And you could see in Luke 1:67-79, he's rejoicing that his son, Johnny B, otherwise known as John the Baptist, but that Johnny be good, because Johnny was going to be the prophet for the coming Savior. So he said that, and being filled with the Spirit. So Elizabeth and her husband Zechariah were both filled with the Holy Spirit, and knew that this virgin birth that was going to happen through Mary was going to produce the Savior. They would not have known that except for the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit prophesied it to Joseph and Mary. He conceived Christ in Mary, and he also was also letting other people know what was going to happen in this celebration of the coming of the Savior. That's the Holy Spirit's role in the virgin birth. He predicted it, he performed it, and he rejoiced in it. Right. So when we start the ministry of Jesus, we see the Holy Spirit there from the beginning. Then we get to his earthly ministry. Now remember, Jesus is 30 years old when he begins his earthly ministry. Right, and he was obviously a bright kid. He obviously knew the scriptures. He obviously was a sinless kid. Can you imagine being a sibling of Jesus growing up? Well, why can't you be more like your brother Jesus, you know, who never sinned, you know, and we're always sinning? How are we going to be compared? Even when you're good, you're not as good as Jesus. And so that must have been really tough for James and Jude and and some of the other siblings of the sisters of Jesus, because they can never measure up to the oldest. But you know, of course, we know Jesus dazzled the teachers in the temple because he wrote the Old Testament. So he was able to outteach even the smartest teachers there. But he didn't begin his earthly ministry until he was 30. It would last 3 years until he was crucified at 33 years of age. And so, we believe that the Holy Spirit was in working in Jesus that whole time. But when Jesus started his 3 year ministry as the Messiah, remember, before he was Jesus the carpenter, and he was the brother of the son of Joseph, you know, another carpenter, and so you know, he was the guy who did ethical work. He was the guy that you wanted to go to get your tables made, you know, or your furniture made. And when he started his ministry, we remember that his baptism was the initiation of his earthly ministry. But the Holy Spirit is the empowering agent in Christ's earthly ministry. Why? First, to fulfill Old Testament prophecy. Isaiah gives some tremendous verses about the shoot that will come forth from the stump of Jesse. Who's Jesse? That's King David's dad, right? So out of the loin of Jesse and King David, shall come forth from the roots to bear fruit, and the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. So here, the Messiah, we learn a couple of things from this verse. It's going to come from the line of Jesse, David, and is going to be empowered by the Spirit of God. Isaiah 42:1. Behold, my Spirit, my servant, whom I uphold, my elect one, in whom my soul delights, I have put my Spirit upon him. Isaiah 61:1, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. And so these are all passages referring to the Messiah, written 700 years before Jesus actually came. You know, I mean, 700 years, that's three times older than our Declaration of Independence, right? I mean, that's an incredibly old prophecy that that talks about the Holy Spirit coming upon Jesus. So one of the reasons is to fulfill Old Testament prophecy. Another reason is to empower Christ in his humanity. If you remember, we talked about what was called the kenosis of Christ in last semester. The kenosis of Christ means the emptying of. Now, this does not mean that Jesus emptied himself of his divine powers, or he stopped being God, or he stopped having attributes. No. What it means is that even though he was God, he made himself of no reputation. He didn't need the reputation of being God, taking on the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men. And so we had defined this sense of kenosis as not giving up his deity or his attributes, but veiling the voluntary use of his divine attributes. He had them, he just didn't need to show them off. Right? He didn't, and so he veiled his ability to, he veiled the voluntary use of his attributes. That's I think really the best, most accurate way to say it. He remains omniscient, but he allowed himself to not know when he would come again. Right? He was all powerful, and yet he was weak and hungry. He was everywhere present, and yet he was physically present where people stood in line and crowds just to see him. And so here is that sense that when he emptied himself, he then allowed himself to become dependent on the Holy Spirit to empower many of his miracles. And so again, why did he allow the Holy Spirit to do this. It's this great partnership that fulfills prophecy and that empowers his humanity. And so as we understand kind of the why, here we kind of take a look at the what. That the essence of the Holy Spirit is in the ministry of Christ. So here we see just some clear declarations fulfilling the Old Testament in the new. You know, the Old Testament said the Lord is the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. You know, Jesus confirms that in him in Luke 4:18. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me. He is claiming the fulfillment of Isaiah 61:1 in him because he is Christ the anointed one. Now, what does it mean to be anointed? In the Old Testament, priests and kings were anointed by olive oil. All right, not Popeye or Bluto or Wimpy, but they were anointed by olive oil. All right, but it's the oil itself. All right, and so the oil is actually a picture of the Holy Spirit, and when kings and priests were anointed, that would be a way of confirming their role as king and priest. When the Holy Spirit anointed Jesus Christ, that was confirming that he is the anointed one or the Messiah. The word Christ literally means the anointed one. The word Christ is the Hebrew equivalent for Messiah, the anticipated coming one, the anointed one. So when we say Jesus, that's his earthly name, his human name. But Christ is really his title. He is the anointed. And it was the Spirit of God that anointed him, recognizing him as the Christ. Acts 10:38, God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit. And also note, and with power. It doesn't mean Jesus was weak. No. In his humanity, he veiled the voluntary use of his attributes, and he relied on the Holy Spirit's power, who went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. Right, so that's a very important verse, Acts 10:38, to understand that this anointing by the Spirit came with the power to do the miracles that Jesus was doing. So anointing basically means he's recognized as the ultimate high priest, as the ultimate king of kings, and as the ultimate sacrifice. You know, he is the Messiah anointed by the Spirit with power to do miracles that would recognize what he has done. All right. So not only do we see that Christ was anointed by the Spirit, We see he was filled with the Spirit. As Isaiah said, I put my Spirit upon him. Luke 4:1 says, Jesus, being filled with the Holy Spirit, returned to Jordan and was led by the Spirit into wilderness. All right, so this is interesting. What is Luke 4:1 referred to? All right, this is right after the baptism, where the Father spoke, this is my Son in whom I am well pleased. And then the Holy Spirit descended like a dove, not as a dove, but like a dove, descended on the person of Christ. And then Jesus, being filled with the Holy Spirit, he returned from the Jordan, and then he was led by who? The Holy Spirit. He was led into the wilderness. Now, if you keep reading, we know why he was in the wilderness for 40 days, being tempted and tested by the devil. And it was the Holy Spirit who was enabling Christ and giving Christ that strength to endure temptation for 40 days. All right. So the Spirit of God filled Jesus and enabled him to do this. Could Jesus do this on his own? Absolutely. All right. But this is a great example on how Jesus yielded to the power of the Holy Spirit during temptation for us. And if Jesus relied on the Holy Spirit, how much more do we need to rely on the Holy Spirit? Greg Allison and Andreas Kostenberger, on their book, The Holy Spirit, said, Jesus does not repel temptations as the Son incarnate apart from the Holy Spirit, who indwells Jesus without measure. Rather, it is the God-man filled with the Holy Spirit who faces down Satan and defeats all the temptations thrust at him. All right, so, you know, so that this is a partnership where Jesus is there and he's depending on the power of the Holy Spirit. And so together they are working. Now, could Jesus have done it on his own? Sure. Could the Spirit have done it on his own? Absolutely. All right. But this happened to fulfill prophecy and to, as a result of Jesus veiling the voluntary use of his attributes, and also to be an example for us. Now, note that Jesus was endowed by limitless spiritual ability, right? John 3, for he gives the Spirit without measure, right? So it's, you go to the Joanne's fabric store and you say, oh, I'd like a yard of fabric, and they'll measure you a yard and you'll get a yard, right? Maybe you get 1 or 2 inches more, you know, or you go to the baker and you ask for a dozen donuts and he gives you a baker dozen, you know, and so you get 13 instead of 12, which, you know, which is nice. I don't know they do that much anymore. But you know, still, even if you get a baker's dozen, it's still a measure. It's still limited. But the Holy Spirit in the life of Christ and in us as well is limitless. And that's something that we need to realize. You know, we don't use up our allotment of the Holy Spirit by the end of the day. He comes regularly and limitlessly, as he did for Jesus, he does for us. Christ was also led by the Spirit, right? Immediately the Spirit drove him into the wilderness. Luke 4:14, Jesus returned the power of the Spirit to Galilee. Right. So at the end of the temptation, then he follows the Spirit to the next place. All right. So here, instead of a GPS and instead of a Google calendar, Jesus had the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit was sending him where he needed to go and took him to where he needed to go. And, you know, it's possible when it says immediately the Spirit drove him into the wilderness, it could have been zoop. You know, just, you know, no walking, no chariot, you know, no airplane, you know, it's possible that that's what that means, that he just zipped him over there. You know, we see that in the book of Acts, you know, with Philip, you know, and so it's possible that that's what that could mean as well. But the point is he was led by the Spirit. And again, if Jesus is led by the Spirit, how much more should we be led by the Spirit? And then here's another neat thing about their relationship. They shared joy together. In that hour, Jesus rejoiced in the Spirit and said, I thank you, Father, Lord God of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these from the wise and prudent. Even so, Father, so it seemed good in your sight. So here, what are we seeing here? The Son and the Spirit are rejoicing with the Father, right? So here you're seeing this triunity with Christ and the Spirit and the Father. And so we're seeing the Trinity and its beauty, sharing joy, you know, just kind of like, you know, just watching some of you guys, you know, Clayton and Lori enjoying, you know, their vacation together, or Carol Lee pretending to be in Hawaii with Doc, right? But just sharing in the joy. Right. And that's the Trinity is doing that. They share joy with each other, you know, and that's again, showing that, yeah, could they do it on their own? They could, but they've chosen to do it together. Why? It's a beautiful picture for us. And it shows the love that they have for each other. The Father loves the Son. The Son loves the Spirit. the Spirit loves the Son and the Spirit loves the Father, right? And so, you know, I don't know if I covered all the bases, but you get the point. They love each other and they work together. And what we are seeing is them working together. If God can work together, then how much more should we be working together, you know, in unity, in the Spirit? And so here we start to see the what of the why, all right, to fulfill prophecy, to empower Christ when he voluntarily veiled the use of his ability. It's kind of like saying, you know what? It's kind of like this. This weekend, we're having a conference on the Book of Jude. I'm one of the speakers, and there's two other speakers. And so I was set to speak the last message on Jude, because I was trying to leave earlier because we have an appointment back here, I asked if I could take the early morning one on Saturday. So we switched topics. So it's kind of like, I could have spoken that passage, but I'll go ahead and do this. And I'm going to let my buddy preach the message that I was going to preach. So it's like, I could have done that one. I prepared it already. And, you know, and my buddy's also been preaching on Jude. So he's, you know, he could do that. So even though we could have done it, we're letting each other do it. I could have done them all, right? The other guys could have done them all, but we chose, no, we're each going to take one session so we can share with each other. So even though we could have done it all, we chose to partner with each other because there's a wonderful dynamic in partnering with each other. And the same thing with Jesus and the Holy Spirit. Jesus could have done it just on his own. And the Spirit could have done it just on his own, or the Father could have done it just on his own. But to work together in this triune team is marvelous. It shows love. It shows the interdependence and, you know, and interworking there. And that's why they share joy. All right, I'm going to take a moment to see if you have any questions thus far, and then I'll show you in different ways the Spirit enabled Jesus. Any questions so far? Ookie dookie. Then let's jump over here to the next part here, which is the enablement of the Holy Spirit in the ministry of Christ. Then Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit to Galilee. All right, so now we finished the baptism, 40 days of temptation, and the Spirit is empowering Jesus to resist the temptation. And not that Jesus could have ever sinned because he's God, you know, that's a whole nother story. But the Spirit was working in Christ in fending off those attacks. You know, it wasn't that Jesus was lured to lust or to sin or to be mean or to cruel, but by, for example, denying himself food, even though the devil's saying, oh, why don't you just eat this? He was hungry, right? So he went through the physical pain of being hungry to eat when it was going to be the right time to eat, not when the devil was saying to eat. You know, or saying, well, why don't you just drop yourself off, off this ledge, you know, and then let the angels pick you up, you know? Well, it wasn't God's will to do that, right? And so here, by resisting the temptation, it's not like, oh, you know, he could have lusted, or he could have been angry, or he could have stolen. No, it's, But by him resisting what was being tempted caused great physical agony, and the Holy Spirit helped him get through that. All right, so that's kind of a key thought when we deal with that temptation of Jesus. So from baptism to temptation, then he goes to Galilee, And that's when he starts, his ministry there, you know, after kind of going through, after being recognized as a Messiah, being tested, after being recognized. Then he starts preaching, right? So here we're in Luke 4:18. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He sent me to heal the brokenhearted and to proclaim liberty to the captives. So here he's Spirit enabled to preach. Okay, now this convicts me, right? If Jesus depended on the Spirit to preach, how much more should I be dependent on the Spirit of God to preach? Because I'm not God. I'm not Christ, right? And so, and yet, he allowed the Spirit to enable him in preaching. The Spirit also enabled Christ to perform miracles. And so, so in performing miracles, here, we read this verse earlier, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. He went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. So what's interesting is that if you would read the book of John, the Gospel of John, for example, John really focuses on Jesus' ability to do miracles, right? As, you know, you look, particularly the signs of water to wine, feeding 5,000, walking on water, raising Lazarus, and other healings. John focused on Jesus' ability to affirm, you know, he is God. Now, Luke focused on, because Luke is picturing how Jesus is the perfect man, right? John focuses on how he's the perfect God. And so he's writing, they're writing different audiences. It doesn't contradict each other. It's just a different emphasis. John is looking from deity down to man. And then Luke, who's writing to a Greek audience, is trying to present Jesus as the perfect man who is God, who is the son of man, and being the perfect man. And so here, Luke, who writes Acts, is emphasizing Jesus of Nazareth did this in the power of the Holy Spirit. So you might say, well, which is it? Is it Jesus or is it the Holy Spirit? It's both. It's God the Father as well. Right, it's the Trinity working all together in the miracles. So this means, did Jesus do it? Yes. Did the Holy Spirit do it as well? Yes. All right, so don't discount the Holy Spirit. Don't discount Jesus. Don't have such a dichotomy that it's one or the other, because it was all of them. And so, you know, as Allison and Kostenberger said, our pneumatology descends from such dichotomizing of the person and work in relation to the Holy Spirit. We don't need to keep cutting it all up as a dichotomy. It's working together, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. But our emphasis tonight is that the Holy Spirit was there. Don't forget him. The Father's there, the Son's there, and so is the Holy Spirit. Just don't forget the Holy Spirit, which we might tend to do. Some of the things that we see the Holy Spirit empowering is the healing of the blind, possessing divine wisdom, casting out demons, but also the importance of the Spirit. It was also really important that the Spirit receive credit for these miracles, because there were some people who were critical of where did Jesus get this power to do these miracles. Was it the devil? And if they said that, and it was the power of the Holy Spirit that did that, that was considered the blaspheme of the Holy Spirit. So I don't know if you've ever heard that phrase before. You know, what is the blaspheming of the Holy Spirit? It says right here in Matthew, but if I cast out demons by the Spirit of God, surely the kingdom of God has come upon you. Therefore, I say to you, every sin and blasphemy, you know, there's a chance that you can be forgiven, he says, will be forgiven men. But the blasphemy against the Spirit will not be forgiven men. Anyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man, it'll be forgiven him. But whoever speaks against the Holy Spirit, it will not be forgiven him, either in this age or in the age to come. So we ask the question, what does it mean to blaspheme the Holy Spirit? This is, again, in the ministry of Christ, being empowered by the Holy Spirit, bringing on the kingdom of God, and certifying it with these miracles done in the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, if we start to say, oh, that wasn't the Spirit of God, that was the devil, right? That was demons that's empowering him. That would be blaspheming the Holy Spirit. And that is what we would call the unpardonable sin, right? Because it says it will not be forgiven him. You can speak against Christ and be forgiven, but you can't speak against the Holy Spirit and be forgiven. Now, people might say, well, it says either in this age or in the age to come. So that means can we blaspheme the Holy Spirit today? I don't believe so, because Christ isn't here doing miracles in the power of the Holy Spirit. Right. So I think it applies to that situation. And so, where it would be unpardonable and unforgivable because of the context of when that happened. You know, why is it so blasphemous? Well, the Holy Spirit is part of the triune God. And to identify the Holy Spirit as Satan is to basically call God the devil, all right? Jesus said, you can call me that, you know, and be forgiven, you know, because, you know, I'm here. I'm the obvious one that you want to attack with your Antichrist, you know, you'll be forgiven. But you call the power of the Spirit as a work of the devil, that is unforgivable. Why is it so, It's the Pharisees who were religious, who had proof before them that prophecies that the Holy Spirit was going to do this work, and they neglected the prophecies. They neglected the clear working of miracles that could not be replicated by any magician or human or raising the dead, feeding the 5,000, stealing a calming a storm or walking on water. I mean, those could not be replicated by any human being in reality. And so there are different views of the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit if it can be done today. I believe that it's not repeatable today in the absence of the physical presence of Christ and his miracles. There are some who think that it could be in different ways and aspects. It's all on your notes. I'm not going to go into detail, but basically, I don't believe it can be replicated today. One more thought on this, and as we kind of head down the home stretch, and then we'll open it up for questions. But there were some instances of Jesus doing miracles on his own. Now, that doesn't mean he did it apart from the Holy Spirit. Again, we're just noting how it's phrased here. You know, Jesus immediately knowing in himself that power had gone out of him, said, daughter, your faith has made you well, go in peace. Or the power of the Lord was present to heal them, you know? And so again, we're not cutting up who gets credit for this miracle or who gets credit for this miracle. We know it was all three because they're mentioned as all three. So the Holy Spirit was involved in the virgin birth. The Holy Spirit was involved, in the earthly ministry of Jesus. The Holy Spirit was also strengthening Christ during his suffering and death. Even much more will the blood of Christ, through the eternal Spirit, offered himself without blemish to God, purify our conscience from dead works to serve the living God. So Christ offered himself to God in death through the power of the Holy Spirit, you know. And so I believe the eternal Spirit is the Holy Spirit himself. There are some who would just say, oh, well, that could be the Spirit of Christ. But I think it makes sense that it's the Holy Spirit who's been working in Christ. And how was this exactly done? That in the eternal Spirit offered himself, we don't know, but You know, but it does. But this is what the text says, is that when he offered himself as a blood sacrifice, it was the eternal spirit that was offering him. So the Holy Spirit's involved in Jesus at his birth, in his ministry, in his suffering and death. And then the Holy Spirit, and we're just running the whole gamut of Jesus's life here. He's involved in the resurrection. All right. So birth, ministry, death, and resurrection. So here's some cool verses. Christ suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might be, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but being made alive by the Spirit. Right? So the Holy Spirit is involved in the resurrection. You know who else is involved in the resurrection? God the Father and God the Son. I mean, that, you know, in our resurrection lesson, you can go back to the notes. We see that the Father was involved, the Son was involved, and the Holy Spirit is involved. These are the verses that mention how the Holy Spirit is involved. Romans 8, 11. But if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. All right. So he's saying the Holy Spirit that dwells in you, he's the one that raised Jesus from the dead. Why are we facing defeat? Why are we living like losers when the Holy Spirit who dwells in us raised Jesus from the dead, right? That's the same Holy Spirit. So again, two references to the Holy Spirit involved in raising Christ from the dead. Romans 1:4, declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. So again, another connection of the Holy Spirit to the resurrection of Christ. So here's what we have seen today and gleaned. The Holy Spirit and Christ are in this essential partnership with God the Father. All right, now we don't want to neglect God the Father either. But what we're trying to do is draw attention on the Holy Spirit, who we normally forget and don't pay attention to. Or we start thinking, well, you know, the Holy Spirit really isn't, you know, big until now, you know, until after Pentecost in the New Testament and the church. No. We've taken a look at what he's done in the Old Testament. We've taken a look what he's done in the life of Christ, from his virgin birth to his ministry to his death on the cross to his resurrection. And this has been a vital partnership. He kind of done it on his own, but the key of partnership is so important. So just to wrap it up tonight, if Christ was dependent on the Holy Spirit, how much more should we? You know, he does that as a lesson to us. But also, as we see the clear role of the Holy Spirit in the life and ministry of Christ, my bad spelling there. It was late and I was in a rush. But we are further convinced, one day I'll learn how to spell R, but we are further convinced of the Holy Spirit's personhood and deity, right? So we see the Holy Spirit in the life and ministry of Christ, and we see that he is a person who, he's not just a force, right? But he is in step with Christ in his ministry every step of the way as a partner, right? As an empowering partner. And when we get to the part where he fills us, where he indwells us, he's doing that for us right now. So it's an incredible illustration in the life of Christ of what he's doing and indwelling our lives today. And so I think these are some of the key takeaways that we can take. And so that's what I have for us tonight. If any of you have any questions about the Holy Spirit, feel free to unmute yourself and we'll see what we can do here. Any questions? Well, if not, I'm going to close in prayer. I'll stop the recording. You can still ask questions afterwards, but let me close in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for the amazing scriptures that describe the Holy Spirit in the life of Jesus. And we know Jesus could have done it alone. We know the Holy Spirit could have done it alone, and you could have done everything alone. But Father, the very fact that there was an amazing partnership in the ministry of Jesus Christ declares the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. We know the Holy Spirit's ministry priority is to glorify Christ. And we know the Son's ministry priority is to glorify you, O Father. And Father, we see this amazing a partnership of the triune God. And so, Father, thank you for what we can take away, even from the virgin birth to the miraculous empowered ministry of miracles and preaching of Jesus to his death on the cross and even his resurrection done by the Holy Spirit and you and the Son as well. So, Father, thank you that we can continue to be in awe of the work of the Trinity and to be amazed about how awesome and wonderful our God is, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, in whom we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Steve.